not afraid of something? Yeah, we're all afraid of something. Different somethings, but we're all afraid of something. Do you know, as I was preparing for my talk, do you know that there is actually a fear of fear? It's called phobophobia. Phobophobia. Afraid of being afraid. I can kind of relate to that, you know? We don't like to be afraid, do we? No. So we're talking this entire month of May about this deep and holy hunger we have for our wholeness. And a big part of that is being willing to embrace our shadow side, our shadow self. That part of us that is afraid. Sometimes we don't even know what we're afraid of, but we just know we have these fears that reside within us that are difficult to deal with. And so in this entire month, we are talking about cultivating the capacity and the courage to allow the vulnerability that we feel as human beings to come forward, to bring that into the day of light, a light of day. I love the lyrics to the song that Jordan Smith sang, Standing in the Light. See, once light is shown on anything, it begins to heal. It begins to heal. And so that's what we're talking about today, moving away from our fear of the dark so that we can heal, so that we can be free, so that we can let our hearts speak rather than our fears speak. And this brings us into a wholehearted way of being present with our life experience. But the problem is, it's very difficult to overcome that sense of vulnerability. Does anybody not feel vulnerable to something in their life experience? Vulnerable to maybe not enough? Scarcity? Vulnerable to the boogeyman? The big bad wolf, whatever that thing is, we get thrown into fear in so many ways. And of course, in our culture, we have an added attraction, and that is the news, media. If you're not enough fear, if there's not enough reason to be afraid in your own life, all you need to do is turn on the TV, turn on the radio, and somebody's going to help you find something to be afraid of, and that's just a fact. So when we are afraid, when we are moving into that place of overwhelm, what happens is we begin to focus on our weaknesses, on our fragility, on that sense of being powerless and frightened in our life experience. We're forgetting our power. We're forgetting our connection with the bigger self, you see. We're afraid to lose our safety. We're afraid that if life is uncertain, and I can tell you absolutely, my life has been uncertain most of my almost 70 years. I hardly ever know what's going to happen next. I hardly ever know what uninvited thing is going to come right around the corner and say, yoo-hoo, here I am. And sometimes it's frightening. Sometimes it's scary. And so what happens is I sort of gear myself up, you know? I sort of get that armor on so that I'm going, yep, I think it's going to come. I better be ready for it. You know how that works? And we get our adrenaline going up because we have a fear that something terrible is going to happen. And when we have that fear, when we're always looking for something, that unknown something that's out there that's going to hurt us in one way or another, hurt us physically, hurt our hearts, hurt our safety, hurt someone that we love, all of a sudden, these unknown fears that might hurt us start ruling our lives. Now, don't hear me say that there isn't such a thing as good fear, because our primal selves tell us not to touch something hot. Fear of the getting burned, that's a good thing. Being safe in the world, there are some real practical aspects to that. That primal response to certain kinds of things keeps us from falling off the ledge, so to speak, right? It keeps us from going to the edge of our experience and then, you know, falling into the abyss. But when we are not able to sort of monitor our fear, what happens is our physiology takes over. And all of a sudden, we get flooded with adrenaline, we get all of our muscles, you know, get ready to run. And guess what happens when that happens? When we are filled with adrenaline, when we're worrying, when we're always on guard and on alert, and we've got that primal state of fear going on in our physiology, our human bodies, guess what happens to our brain? We get dumber. We get dumber. When we're in that adrenaline place and we're ready to run, you know, that fight or flight place, because, okay, so now, this is what I know about myself. A lot of the things I'm afraid of or I think might happen or the unknown things that might rock my safety never happen. But guess what happens? My body is ready to run. Yes? That's what worry is about, folks. That's what worry is all about. We get worried, we're afraid of things, and whatever that thing is in the dark that we're, you know, we can't see it, but we gear for it. And then all of a sudden, our brain goes numb, and we can't think of creative possibilities. We can't think it through. Do you know how this works? Think of an experience in your own life where you've been frozen in fear, and you can't think. It's like, I can't think how to get through this thing right now. That's what happens to us. And then we're off and running. And then the fear, I happen to have panic disorder. So what happens is the fear gets running, and then I'm afraid of the panic. I'm afraid of the fear. Do you know how this works? Yes. We get afraid, and it starts this cycle, and pretty soon we get paralyzed. Pretty soon we collapse into that experience. And you know what it is? It's all about thoughts. It's all about the thoughts that we're holding in our minds. It is not happening. Usually it's not even happening. Now sometimes it is. And then we have to rise to the occasion. We've got to remember the truth of who we are and do what we got to do. So sometimes we actually have to take action. But I know for myself, a lot of the fear of the dark has to do with stuff that's not even happening. It's happening here in my head. It's about my thoughts, see? It's this, what our author calls unbridled imagination that gets going, see? What if? I start making things up in my mind. I start creating the story. And it's not even real. I start giving everyone a role. I start writing this script for everybody and everything. Right? And of course, I'm the star. I'm right in the middle of it. I get to be the star of the drama. Right? But all of a sudden, I'm making up this big story. And then I give my power to that thing, whatever that thing is. Whatever that thing I'm afraid of. And now, all of a sudden, I see it everywhere. Everywhere I look, I see a reason to be afraid. Do you know how that works? I look at the news. I look at the political situation. I look at the terrorists. I look at this. And all of a sudden, my life is going to hell in a handbasket at a personal level and at a global level. You know how that works? And we can get collapsed into that. And what I know about this is it's a lot easier when we can actually put our finger on what we're afraid of. So I have a phobia of snakes. I mean, it is overwhelming. If I saw a snake now, I'd probably pass out. It's that kind of thing. But that's easier to deal with, isn't it? Because we know. If we have a fear of heights, we just don't go up high, right? But these things that we don't know about, these are the things that drive us. I was thinking about an example of what are we afraid of? And I was thinking how we get conditioned. And many years ago, my parents, my mom and my dad, were helping one of my sister's friends who was in the hospital, and she had several small children. And one of the children needed a caretaker. And he wasn't real familiar with my parents, but he had met them several times. And so, but he was a tiny guy. So they're at St. Joseph's Hospital, and here this little guy is with my big parents in his elevator at St. Joseph's going to the first floor, and he looked up at these huge people, and he said, "What's a stranger? What's a stranger?" There's that part of us, you know, that book, should I be afraid here? There's a part of him that knew it was safe, you know what I'm saying? But there was another part of him that had been sort of conditioned and sort of, is this a boogeyman experience? I'm not quite sure about this. I'm not quite sure about this. So I chose this image behind me, the rabbit hole, Alice in Wonderland. Sometimes it feels like we're not quite sure. Are you strangers or are you friendly folks, you know? Is this a never-ending dark tunnel that I'm entering into, or is there a light at the end of this tunnel? And what I know is that when we forget that there is light, that we can stand in the light, you know, a lot of times we've got some traumas that have set in. We're going to work with that today in the Evolve Workshop, and we're going to work with it on May 15th in the Enneagram class. We've got a lot of stuff that gets in the way that makes us catastrophize our life experience. We've had traumas. Anybody know I had a trauma here? We've had childhood messages that make us feel unsafe in the world. We have, maybe some of us have come through very unsafe holding environments. We didn't have a safe home, safe parents, safe family, safe whatever. We've come through these experiences, and then what happens is we've got the fear of the dark settles around things like being abandoned, not being loved, not being worthy, not being safe, not finding a secure place, not having enough, like Glenda's story talked about, not having enough to eat, those kinds of things. And then these things start showing up everywhere in our life experience and become the source of our worry and our anxiety. And so all of a sudden, we have these things that are happening right now. We have our own thoughts, and guess what? We can carry around a whole bunch of shadow stuff, this baggage stuff that we've accumulated over a lifetime. And all of a sudden, we have all of these incredible ways that we can be afraid of the unknown, afraid of the dark. And it's actually a fear of not knowing. I like Daniel Naylon's song. I don't need to know, God knows. But when I don't know what's going on, I can tell you something. I usually feel a little bit off center. You know how that is when I don't know? And this idea of always being in the question doesn't always feel good. So this morning, one of my sisters in San Diego, you've heard me talk about her a lot over the last couple of years. She emailed me, she watches our talks, she watches Common Ground, because she's in San Diego and we're here. And she had asked me previously what the talk was all about. I told her fear of the dark. And she said, this is what she said this morning, and I thought, this is the idea that we need to get across. She says, I bet your talk today will be really powerful. Fear of the dark is a big deal. Facing fear takes so much courage. It makes all the difference in the world to have someone stand by and ease the fears of you, as you have done for me. It can become overwhelming if you're doing it alone. Now this is the part that caught my attention. She says, gee, I just remembered. There's divine assistance. I never think of that in the moment. So that's what we're talking about here. We get so distracted by the problem. We get so out of tune with the bigger picture that there's always that something that is supporting our journey. And in her case, she's writing all about facing fear and her own courage and then what she perceives as my support of her. And then she backs up and she says, wait a minute. Now I remember. I don't need to worry. God's worrying for me. I don't need to know. God knows. There's divine assistance here. And that's what happens to us when we're frozen in fear. We forget that. We forget our capacity to stand in the light and be who we are. We forget that when we bring the light of day to all of this stuff that's gotten in the way for us, that there is a divine assistance right in the middle of it. So the fear comes when we close down to that knowing, when we close down to that connection with that greater than we are thing, that higher self that is there to get us through all of it. Really, it's about embracing the great mystery, and that's not a real comfortable place to be if you like certainty. That's for sure. So when we're clear that somewhere within that dark tunnel there is light, it makes life a lot easier. It makes it not so scary. We're not so afraid of the darkness when we know that there is light. And you know what the antidote is? If you take nothing else from this talk today, this is the clue. The antidote to fear of the dark is basic trust. Basic trust in the divine. Basic trust in your higher self to get you through it. So here's your invitation. Have the courage to allow yourself to be vulnerable enough to take a look at all the stuff you're afraid of, all the dark places, all the shadow places. Bring it to the light of day. Let it be exposed. Let it be, you know, share it with a safe person. Let it come out. Decide that you don't want to give your power to that thing, whatever it is, to that unknown, that unseen, and probably is never going to happen thing, that uninvited whatever. And then remember what my sister finally remembered as she was emailing this long text to me this morning. Gee, I just remembered there's divine assistance. I never think of that in the moment of crisis. Thank you for listening.